101. It was meant to educate on the various aspects of publishing. So it was primarily for those who wanted to really know a little about publishing and how the whole process works. And for that, we have a very experienced publisher. We have Ms. Ritu Menon, who started way back as one of the first feminist publishing houses in India. It was called Tally for Women. And she
Association of Indian Publishers, I think it was, and they have compiled some data for the book trade, which is what I'm going to be using, which is what this is based on. I think that this could be, I know that it's available with Leonard, so if any of you need it, perhaps you could just ask him for it later. So the print book market is estimated to be worth roughly 26,000 crores. It sounds like a lot, but it's actually less than one Reliance company. Publishing is what we call a peanuts industry in India. I should explain that. It's a peanuts industry because the rolling stock of publishing worldwide is educational publishing. That is your bread and butter. It provides the financial basis for all other publishing. Educational publishing in India is state controlled. It is not open to the private sector except in a very small percentage. So the large, huge volume that educational publishing represents is not available to the private sector by and large. A very tiny percentage is available to a handful of publishers. And this is because, of course, the main educational publishing is in the languages. So each state will have its state board of education, which produces the teaching material, the educational material. It's a very good reason for that. Education is free when it is state supported. And all the teaching material is also heavily, heavily subsidized. So the quantum of the Indian publishing, the volume, the money, the finance is actually quite small. But the market is growing, and it's growing primarily because there is a huge expansion of the middle class, one, and a huge expansion of youth, what we call between 18 to 25, but it can expand a little bit on either side. So it growing at 20% is pretty huge. India is the sixth largest book market in the world. And it is the second largest in the world for books in English, second after the US. And that's really because of the numbers, of the huge volume that the country, the reading market represents. I mentioned the educational sector, and I should say that it accounts for 70% of the book market. So that is, you can see the proportionate, the balance between educational and what we call general. What is general? All this information is on this thing, so you know you can access it quite readily. According to this Nielsen report, there are only 9,000 active publishers in the country. And as I said, because we have no precise data, we don't really know how these publishers are defined. You could be a publisher of 5 books a year when you pass out. You could be a publisher of 350 books a year, but you're all in the same basket. But there is another agency, which is the Rajaram Mohan Roy Library, which maybe some of you are familiar with. It is a national agency which assigns the international standard book number to publishers. Is everybody familiar with the ISBN? Does somebody not know what ISBN signifies? Everybody knows? Okay, the ISBN is an international standard book number which is administered uniquely to every publisher in the world. And if you have that standard book number, you are identified by it worldwide. it's a unique identification. So the international standard book numbers in India are issued by the Raja Ram Mohan Roy Library, which is a national library but based in Calcutta. And that library says that since 1985, which is 30 years ago, they have actually assigned 19,000 ISBNs. Now, that is a far larger figure than what the Nielsen report reports as active publishers. So what this means is there may well be 19,000 publishers, but not all of them are active. So it's as I said, a general figure, but at least we have it. We have something. Of the 9,000 publishers that the Nielsen report has reported as being active, only 900, that is a fraction, are trade publishers. The rest are independent. Fosbro, who lived in a tiny village in Karnataka. He lived in a place called Nilgaon, which is where he set up a rural school for children, for rural children. And I'm speaking about the late 70s, up until the late 70s, early 80s. David used to send all his manuscript by post, which we received. Nothing was ever lost in transit. And all the books that he wanted were sent to him by BPP. And he got them. Like everybody else. Actually, you might remember, David was an OUP author as well. But this was something astonishingly efficient. And so that service actually now is hardly available. Like telegrams, BPP doesn't exist. Now, if you're in a small town or a small little village, even villages now are serviced, I suppose, by the net, your only resource is an e-tailer. But I'm saying that the lack of bookshops was sort of compensated for a little bit by some of these other facilities that used to be around, that are no longer around, which is I suppose an indication of it is still there, yes, but because the postal services are cutting down on deliveries, this is also not nearly as efficient as it used to be. Money orders are still possible to send and so on. Yes, I also still use BPP, but as I say, now a lot of people prefer, if they have access to an online retailer, that's what they do, because the advantage of something like Flipkart is that it shares its discount with you. We don't. If it comes directly from the publisher, it's up to the publisher whether they want to give a discount or not. But Flipkart, Amazon, all these people share the discount they get from the publisher with the consumer. That is actually why they are so successful, why they have been so successful. So that little addition is not available if you or I send our books unless we want to. Of course, if I'm sending a book to an author by BPP, we are entitled to a discount. But if someone who sends me, as they used to, send a postcard, they will send a postcard with their requirement and you will send the book by BPP. That arrangement now is, of course, as we used to, as a matter of course. I mean, it was normal to say BPP, send me by BPP. There was a survey done about 10 years ago of new titles published in 18 Indian languages, which indicated that 50% of these were published in Hindi. 26%. Of that 50%, 26% was published in Hindi and 23% in English. So the bulk of the publishing, that is 50%, is accounted for by two languages. And if you want to get an indication of the percentage of books sold by language, that is trade books. I'm not counting educational books in this at all. This discussion is not at all a reference to textbooks, because that's a completely different market, as I said, and we actually don't have figures. But of the total number of trade books sold, 55% are in English and 35% are in Hindi. So English and Hindi account for 90% of all trade books sold, for which we have figures. The share of other languages for new titles published is 9% for Tamil, 7% for Bengali, 7% for Marathi, and 4% for Malayalam. That is just some figures which may or may not be terribly useful, but at least it gives some kind of an overview for the context in which trade was not in English. It was not the Bible. It was a book published in Goa, printed in Goa, not published, printed in Goa, in 1557. And it was called the Doctrina Christa, which was brought out by Christian missionaries. It was obviously a religious book, but it was not the Bible, which is something that we assume, that the first book printed was the Bible. It was not. And it was printed much earlier than we had thought. So 1557 is already very, very early. Actually, the Portuguese pioneered quite a lot of activity in this regard. I can't go into it now, but it's a very interesting history of the firsts that Goa represents in these areas. But actual publishing really only began in the 19th century with the establishment of the Bombay, Calcutta and Madras universities in 1857. Something else also happened in 1857 apart from the First War of Independence. So everybody, many of you know this, I'll just quickly run through it. There are of course different streams of publishing and categories. Educational, trade and general interest, academic, children's, specialist. By specialist I mean law books and so on, but also journals, academic journals. What we call STM, science, technology and medicine, which is a category, which is a distinct category. Self-publishing, what used to be called earlier vanity publishing, but self-publishing, which has become, of course, quite interestingly, potentially very interesting for a lot of new authors or people who don't want to go the regular publishing route. And we'll talk about that a little bit. And then, of course, electronic, which is the I'll just very quickly say one or two things about education publishing, even though I'm not really dealing with it, which is to say that there are, of course, as I said, the states are responsible for most education publishing and they serve the state schools. But there are private schools, of course, and private schools may adopt their own teaching materials. Now, they are bound by curricula and syllabus requirements that are laid down by the Central Board of Secondary Education, of course. They are bound by that. But within that, they do have some leeway about what kinds of textbooks they are going to use. Almost all schools, even the private schools, generally go by the National Book Trust recommended texts. And this has to do with the fact that the secondary school examinations are standard across the country. I want to say something here which we tend to forget, but which is so much a part of our reality that we actually cannot even begin to think of it without keeping it in mind. Imagine, if you will, that the 28 countries of the European Union were one country with one school leaving exam. But the school leaving exam is universal because why? Why is that school leaving exam universal across India? Because mobility for college education has to be across the country. You can be educated in Kerala or in Tamil Nadu or in Assam or wherever and travel across the country for your college education. But how will you do that if there is no single assessment standard? That single assessment standard is why the syllabus has to be complied with unless you go for what is the optional examination, which is the Indian School Leaving Certificate, which has a different syllabus, or of course the International Baccalaureate, which very few students actually opt for. I mean, it's a negligible percentage. Now, the National Book Trust, which was set up as a model sort of, in a sense, taking the diversity of the country into account and the huge variation in across the regions, both linguistic as well as cultural, would compile textbooks that would be that would sort of resonate across the country without being dominated by any one area or one language interest. It was a model agency. They were not supposed to be producing those textbooks. Of course they do. The National Book Trust is probably the largest producer of textbooks in the country. They produce those textbooks and of course sell them at subsidized rates. Now, this has been a bone of contention with the Indian publishing, the private Indian publishing trade for a very, very long time, that you can't exclude us from this profitable sector, A. B, your books are substandard. C, there's no quality control. 4, there's a lot of hierarchy and parochialism and paternalism and patronizing going on in the selection of authors, which there is, etc., etc., etc. So there's been a lot of disquiet in the private trade with the National Book Trust. But on the other hand, the argument against that is that the books are produced in that huge quantity, huge, vast, because they get paper at subsidized rates. It's a government agency, so there's no question of profit. And they are able to subsidize the cost of production, A, because of volume, but B, because everything is subsidized. It's all paid for by the state. And the benefit of that goes to the student. And the student must benefit because the education sector caters to a huge diversity in income. So if education is free, which it is, then the material that is required for that education needs to be subsidized. And that little sort of window which is available to the private trade for private schools was of course the first sector that the British entered into when they began publishing in India. It was the education sector and it continues to be the profitable sector. Oxford University Press, which has now been here for over 100 years and is one of the largest educational school book, in addition to dictionaries and thesauruses and atlases and so on, 98% of their turnover is accounted for by the educational books. Only 2% is available through their trade and general. Now, this is again something which is not commonly known, but in fact, if it were not for their educational books, their references, their dictionaries, their atlases and so on, they would not be able to do what we know as what is the prestige list of OUP, which is their academic and general interest books. So one is enabled by the other hugely. Otherwise, they would not be able to do it. So educational publishing really is it's a critical area which most private publishers simply are not able to access at all. Anyway, so much for educational publishing. The one sector where the private trade, of course, is completely free and has entered hugely is what we call the tertiary, which is college level. Undergraduate, postgraduate, and so on. And that sector is available almost entirely to the private sector, which of course they have used and they continue to use and continue to develop. At the undergraduate level, this is what we call academic publishing. At the undergraduate level, books are prescribed. They are required for the undergraduate student. At the postgraduate level, there are no prescriptions. There is only recommended reading. But the undergraduate prescription is a huge market, as you can imagine. If I were to give you just one indication of it, traditional publishing is not available to us, it's not quite correct. Of course, the numbers are not as huge as they would be for primary, middle, and secondary education, but they are nevertheless vast. They are very, very comfortable numbers. You can make a very comfortable profit, people do, and continue to invest in that sector. Now, obviously, that sector is highly competitive. And there are several, almost every single major publisher in the country, as I say, till 1991 is a critical year for Indian publishing because it was opened up to foreign direct investment for the first time. Publishers like Oxford University Press, etc., were university presses and, till very recently, enjoyed exemption, meaning they could repatriate their profits because they were an academic institution. All that has changed, but I won't go into that now. But what I'm saying is, in 1991, there was a very critical intervention that was very important for Indian publishing, which is that foreign direct investment was allowed. But now, foreign direct investment took place obviously even earlier because there were publishers like Longman and Blackie and Blackwell and McMillan and so on, all of whom have been here for a very long time. But they could never own more than 49% of what they invested. 51% had to be locally owned. In 91, that changed. And immediately, a publishing house like, say, for example, Penguin, which set up in 1984 in India, with 49% holding, and 51% was with this very large Calcutta publishing group called Ananda Bazar Patrika. But immediately in 1991, Penguin and every other new entrant can now be 100% owners of their activities here. This has made for a sea change in the publishing environment. We can go into it later, but all I'm saying is that the impact of this on tertiary level publishing, that is academic publishing, changed dramatically with the entry of academic publishers from outside, Cambridge in addition to Oxford, Sage, Routledge, and others. I mean, it's Harvard now, the latest Harvard, and I dare say others will come in as well. Please stop me if you, you know, want to ask some questions or something, because this is, these are all very, I mean, I can go into a great deal of detail, or I can sort of skim through it. So just let me know if you want something elaborated or not. Prescriptions are made for 3 years. It used to be 3 when the undergraduate degree was 3. Now, of course, some universities have a longer undergraduate, they have another system, could be 4. But they are prescribed for 3 years. So if you get a course prescription, if I'm a publisher and I want to publish, let's say, an annotated guide to Shakespeare, let's say, just for argument's sake, because still very recently, the curricula was also fairly rigidly decided and determined by academic committees and so on. I don't want to go into all that. But let's say I'm a publisher who wants to publish an annotated guide to a text, a particular text that has been prescribed. Imagine, I commission, of course, the writer, I commission the author, usually a teacher, usually a college teacher, almost always. Those books are almost always authored by people who are teaching at university level. And if the book gets adopted, if that text gets adopted across one university, let's say Delhi University with 7 used to be 8 papers, now of course it's all changed, and so many disciplines across the humanities, across political science, across economics, philosophy, etc., etc. Not science, not technology, not medicine, that's a completely different category. But the liberal arts and humanities, you can imagine the sheer volume of that. So, hugely competitive, and it's not always a level playing field. I have to say that as well. But of course it entails then being very, very familiar with the educational market. And if you are an editor who's working with that, then you have to make sure that you know your audience, or rather you know when there may be a course change, you know when the syllabus might change, you know who are the teachers most likely to be able to produce a book, write it, produce it in time for it to be available before the beginning of the academic year. All these are very, very practical considerations, but you still have to be aware of them. And you then have to work with the teachers, with your authors who are writing. Now, each university and each college, or each university certainly, will have different systems by which they change the course material. And so the strategies you adopt will be very different. If you want to be an academic publisher who publishes across the country, you can't only be producing books for one university. Let's say I'm a publisher in Delhi and my focus is Delhi University, but I would also like to have my books in Kerala. I would also like to have my books in Bombay University, in Calcutta University. How does one go about that? Each university will have its separate, even within Delhi. JNU, which is a postgraduate university, has no use for my books because they have no undergraduates at all. But Ambedkar University, which is an undergraduate university, might have a completely different set of requirements. So, I mean, academic publishing is actually quite challenging, and has very, very specific, like trade, has very specific skills that are required in order to be able to do it well. Of course, you can do it and go nowhere with it, but to do it well, to do it successfully, you really have to know exactly which system you're dealing with, which of the state systems you're dealing with. There is, as I said, the other sector in academic publishing, which is the postgraduate, MPhil, PhD, etc. No books are prescribed. There is recommended reading. And if you are a publisher who is like us, for instance, like myself, and many others, many smaller, like Asia, sitting here, with the social science press, we don't do textbooks. That is to say, we don't produce books that are prescribed at the undergraduate level. Nevertheless, we are academic publishers. So what do? We publish those books that may not be prescribed, but that are definitely recommended reading for postgraduate and doctoral students, because after all, they have to have something to read. They're not going to be working only from their undergraduate texts. You move on. Now, these books, so who buys them? I mean, an undergraduate student is probably obliged to buy, if not all the books that are prescribed, a good sum, a good part of them. But if you are not prescribed, if you are an MA student or an MPhil student and the book is not prescribed, are you going to buy it? Not likely, because books are expensive. So what do? You go to libraries. You use the university library or the college library or whatever. And where is the college or the university going to get the funds to buy these books? Because, as you know, college education is practically free across the country. The fees are almost non-existent. So the colleges don't run on fees from students. They are obviously grant-in-aid colleges, they get grants. counter sales to individuals. Retail trade is trade publishing. That is, it is directed at the individual buyer. It is not directed at an institution or a college or a school or any other institutionalized buyer. The target is the individual reader who will go to a bookshop and buy the book over the counter. So it's retail trade dominated is trade publishing, which means, of course, that your net is very, very wide. I mean, I've indicated here, but you may not be able to see it, as it's quite small. So in this is a huge range of books, and very quickly, fiction, graphic novels, translations, general interest nonfiction, what is now called narrative nonfiction, poetry, essays and letters, contemporary politics, journalistic accounts and exposés, memoirs and autobiographies, coffee table, art and architecture, travel, cookbooks, and so on. All of these which dominate the trade publisher. And the trade publishing list, if you like, is always expanding, and expanding in directions that perhaps academic publishing finds it cannot take, because the freedom to innovate in the trade sector is much greater than it is in academic publishing. And we see the result of those innovations. Graphic novels is one, blogs is another, flash fiction, which is which is a contradiction in terms, some might say, but has been very successful. And of course now, as we know, with the newest entrant into the publishing environment, which is this new publisher called Juggernaut, app-based, short, intended for reading on your phone, maybe if you have half an hour. So, but that kind of thing is unthinkable in academic publishing, where other innovations might happen. I'll talk about that later if anyone's interested. But this kind of innovation is simply not possible in academic publishing. So the trade net grows wider and wider, and because it is so wide, it captures public attention, because it has a much larger audience, much, much larger. Not only does it have a much larger audience, but it has a much larger net of writers. As we know, it's very difficult for almost anyone to get up and be an academic writer. You have to have some disciplinary or other qualification. But we do know that in trade publishing, almost anyone can now get up and be a writer, and they do. I mean, they do get up and write, or sit down and write, or do whatever. But what I mean to say is that the whole idea of authorship is now completely open-ended. Completely. I mean, we used, I'm a publisher of long back, so for me, something like this was very liberating in some ways. I mean, I'm an academic, come trade, come everything publisher. I never thought the day would arrive when I would publish blogs. I've done three, very specifically. It's a very interesting challenge. How does somebody who doesn't know where that blog book will go, how to make the decision to publish it? Because the decision to publish is a very important one. India, that has been their main activity, just as their main activity today is to recruit students for universities in Britain. That is their main activity in the country today. No cultural diplomacy anymore except for the output launch. But everything else has been sidelined because income generation. British Council is supported by the income it generates in each of its locations. About 10 years ago, when China decided that manuscripts and you can publish. Why would you want to go and pay whatever commission, 10, 15, whatever percent it varies, to an agent when you already don't know what to do with what you've got? On the off chance that they might have stumbled upon something that the writer did not send you directly. Now, if there was such a writer, maybe you didn't think they were worth it because otherwise they would have sent it to you directly. That was the thinking. That was the assumption. Now, of course, the agents are doing much more than just presenting or, as they say, pitching a writer. They are doing much more. And we can go into that later if anyone is interested. But the institution of the agent was a novelty. It continues to be a novelty. I think there are about three or four agents, Indian agents, who are now in the market. But there are not that many publishers who use their services. And speaking for myself, I know I do.
Excuse me. Can you elaborate a little more on this agency and how far it has developed in India?
Okay. Maybe Manasi can also come in on that. I don't know. She probably, because she deals with rights and things. Now, there are two kinds of agents. There's the homegrown agent, the Indian agent, who operates within India and deals primarily with Indian writers who are located here, who are within the country, who are not expatriates. The way it works is, you hire an agent, if you're a writer, you hire an agent. Maybe Priya is also doing something like this in the next session, I don't know. You hire an agent because you don't really know how to go about finding a publisher. An agent ideally looks at your book or your manuscript, it's not a book yet, looks at your manuscript and assesses which is the publisher most likely to consider it. You see, there's no point bringing a romance book to someone like me, because I don't publish romances. And there's no point taking a graphic novel to Oxford University Press, because they don't publish graphic novels. Okay, so the job of the agent is to study every publisher's publishing profile. Every publisher has a profile. The agent must acquaint themselves and familiarize themselves with what each publishing house does. Now, most trade publishers do almost everything. So they will go from, let's say, from romance or graphic novel all the way to journalistic expose, biography, translations, poetry, cookbooks, coffee table, maybe not coffee table, those are expensive, but cookbooks certainly, fiction of course, non-fiction. And so if your book, your manuscript falls into any of these, then they have a choice of trade publishers to go to, and they will look at the one that is most likely to consider or even offer to read the manuscript. They will send it to more than one. The convention used to be that you don't submit the same manuscript to more than one publisher because you want to give them time to assess it and you want there to be a relationship of trust and of reliability, because it's a developing relationship. I mean, you might have this one particular manuscript, but it's not the only manuscript you're going to give to that publisher. And so the investment is in a very long-term relationship with a range of publishers, not just with one. So you invest in that relationship for the long term. You could, if you so decide, if the agent so decides, you could tell the publisher to whom you are submitting the manuscript first that it's not an exclusive submission, that you will be submitting it to one or two others. exclusive to you, but for a limited period. We can't extend that exclusivity beyond a certain period. Should the book, should the manuscript be accepted by any one of the publishers, then the publisher might say, look, yeah, it's a book that we can consider, but it needs X, Y, Z. You know, you have to tell the author to do this, you have to... Just the other day, and this is why I'm saying there's a difference between the agents here and the agents outside the country. I'll elaborate on that in a minute. A publisher might say, look, it's a work of fiction, but you know, this character isn't well developed enough, or you know, the plot is slow, or you know, it needs a little more whatever. They could come up with a whole lot of recommendations or, and say, if the author is willing to do that, we can take a look again. The agent goes back to the author and says, this is what the publisher has said, are you willing to do this? And the author might say, yes, I can try, or the author might say, no, look for someone else. So then you go back and you try sell the same manuscript to someone else, who might say, yes, I take it, very good, no, it needs no changes at all, it's perfect, it's wonderful, maybe a little bit here and there, you know, she might consider doing this or that, but really no major changes. But we can't give an advance. Sorry, we don't give advances. We'll publish it, but no advance. So, that's today, because agents are working only now. So she goes back to the author, the agent, and says, look, publisher is happy to do it, no changes, but no advance. Okay, says the author, no advance, okay. But how long will they take to publish it? So the agent goes back to the publisher and says, okay, my author is willing to accept no advance, but what's the publishing schedule? And the publisher says, oh, we're full up this year. This is very common. Our program is booked for the next 12 months. Can't do it before that. So it'll be 18 months from now. 12 months we're booked, 6 months in editing and production, okay, 18 months. Earliest. No advance, 18 months. So she goes back to the author and says, 18 months. Author says, no, I'm hypothetical. Author might agree. Okay, well, I've been selling it to so many places, nobody's agreed, at least they've agreed. Okay, 18 months, not happy, but no choice. Or the author might say, no, I took 1 year off my working life to write this book, I didn't get a salary, they're not giving me an advance, I'm not going to get anything, no sales for 18 months, no. Find someone else. The agent might say, I'm sorry, no one else is willing. Either you accept this, or I can't represent you. I've done my best. I don't know where else I can take this book. But if the author agrees to all this, and there may well be a situation where everything that the author wants she gets, everything that the agent negotiates is acceptable, and if that happens, then the contract is signed, and the agent is supposed to help the author through the contract. Now, publishers' contracts, I think there's a session on that. Manasi, I think you're going to do that. So, Manasi will do that this afternoon. You go through the stages of the contract with the agent, and it is the agent's job to negotiate the best terms possible for the author and to keep the author's interests in the foreground. That is, she is acting on behalf of the author. Please remember that whatever the agent negotiates for the author is also in their own best interest, because she gets a percentage of the final negotiated arrangement, whatever it is, whether it's an advance, whether it's a royalty, whether it's subsidiary sales, and there are a whole lot of, it's a very complicated document. The contract getting more and more complicated by the day, I might add. There used to be a time when we did letter contracts. You wrote a letter which had the terms of the agreement, so much royalty, so much advance, of course, license for 5 years or 10 or whatever, that the copyright was held jointly or not, you could sell overseas or not. Finish. One letter, everybody signs, that's it. Now, it is not uncommon, especially because of electronic rights, which are very, very complicated, to have 20-page contracts. The OUP contract runs to 14 pages, I think, and they have all sorts of clauses. I cannot tell you how I'm surprised, actually, at the kinds of conditions that are laid down on authors, and if I were an agent, I would actually advise them not to accept. But, as I say, contracts are becoming much, much more detailed and elaborate, and everybody's rights have to be defended, and the legal implications have to be. No one bothered about libel or defamation or any such thing. I mean, after the I remember the only time that we were careful was during the emergency. The minute the emergency was lifted, there was a flood of books on Mrs. Gandhi. I cannot tell you the most scurrilous writing on Mrs. Gandhi, which nobody ever thought of taking to court, because it would have been thrown out. It was as simple as that. No one ever thought of going to court. The first person who went to court on this was Menaka Gandhi. On Kushwant's book on Sanjay, she was the first person who moved the courts and got a stay, other than Jayalalitha. But Jayalalitha was much later. Menaka was the first person, and all of us thought, what's going on? How can the reviews, you haven't sent the clippings to the author. Why haven't you done that? Where's the royalty statement? Why is it 1 month late? What are all the returns? Why have we got so many returns on this book? She's supposed to do all that. Whether she does it or not is another issue. Does that answer your question?
Yes. Who are the good agents in India?
I'm not going to say. I have no idea because I don't work with them. translation of Purukalayan Haider's River of Fire, which is her great novel. Great, great Urdu novel, which we published in translation in English in 1998. We are now 2016, which means it's been around for close to 20 years. It is in print. It is published in Norwegian, in Italian, in of course it has US and UK publishing it is the easiest part of the job. And that is why so many people go in for self-publishing, because they think, oh, we've got the computer, we've got this program, we've got XYZ. By the way, self-publishing, which we now do online, there used to be something called DTP long back, I don't know if any of you are aware of it, called desktop publishing, which is when you produce laser stuff. You did it all on your desktop computer and then you printed it out as laser and there you go. Desktop publishing, it is called DTP. Lots of people did it. Lots of people now think online, electronic, you know, it's democratized the whole business, we are autonomous, it's all in our control. What's to stop us? Nothing. Nothing to stop you publishing the book, but there's a hell of a lot to stop you from being able to sell it. Because it's not only about making the book and then setting it on its way. Because along the way are thousands of others. And they're all going down the same way. And in our context, in India, the biggest stumbling block to selling is not retail. It's not the absence of retailers. It's the absence of distributors. There are no distributors worth the name. Not one in the whole country. Because it's a huge country and nobody is willing to make the kind of investment in distribution that the country requires. My big question to multinational corporations, and I have asked many of them, is why don't you invest in distribution? Why are you investing only in publishing? Because their claim is that they have professionalized the book trade. And I'm saying, you're not investing in editorial because you're not training anybody. You don't have the time. You're not investing in distribution. So how are you professionalizing the book trade? The simple truth is, no one is going into distribution because nobody in India pays. You cannot make collections. You can send your books out to all the retailers in the world, or rather in the country, through vendors, through distributors, because obviously I can't go to every single city in this vast country and make sure that my books get there. I have to go through somebody, and that somebody, who's the middleman, like all middlemen, have nothing at stake. The distributor invests nothing. They take a book that I have made, that I have paid for, and they give it to somebody who will charge someone else who will pay for it. But this guy, and it's almost always a guy, in the middle, will take 50% for doing us the favor. He will take 50% off the cover price of the book simply for pushing it through from me to the buyer. But when it comes to making collections and paying me for that book, he'll say, I'm sorry, but I'm not getting any payment. Book is not Ashwin Sanghvi. Madam, why you don't do Chetan Bhagat? I'm saying I don't do Chetan Bhagat because Rupa is doing Chetan Bhagat. But you never ask Rupa, why aren't you doing Reshma Veliyappan? Who's she? They will never ask Rupa why they don't do what I do. But they will ask me, Madam, why you don't do one cookbook? And I'm saying, I don't do cookbook because every recipe is available on the net. Why should I do a cookbook? No, no. See, if you do one Saraswat Brahman cookbook, no, in Maharashtra, very good market. Says, Chetan Bhagat is selling, let's have 6 Chetan Bhagats. And editorially driven says, 1 Chetan Bhagat is enough. We don't need clones. Let's do something else. Let's do something that expands the horizon, not narrows it to one writer like this. Talla Dalal, oh my god, when we did Talla Dalal in Vikas, I don't know how many thousands of copies we sold. Like I was told, Amish Tripathi, that first book, what was it? Whatever it was called, that Menuka or something. 8 lakh copies. Every publisher's dream. Every publisher's dream. But at least 6 people rejected that manuscript. Let's not forget that. Chance. Chance. It's a very important factor as well. And any book, frankly, could have that. But who took the risk? Himself. That was one instance where he said, the hell with it, and I will market it in a particular way. Okay, so he did it. But how many others do we know who have done that, whose big books have gone nowhere? We don't even know about them because they've gone nowhere. So it's not the case that when you hit the jackpot once, you can hit it every single time. No, it's not the case. So you need that distributor. And like it or not, you have to pay him 50% or 60, it can go up to 60. And you have to be prepared for returns after 2 years, 3 years. And they will send back hundreds of copies, all of which are useless. They have to be junked because they are not saleable anymore. You have to build that into your pricing. I want to tell you something very interesting. In the US, in the late 60s, a phenomenon called remaindering hit the trade. What was remaindering? Remaindering was the remainder of books that didn't sell after 6 months. Now, warehousing in the US is very, very expensive. Very expensive. And if you had a book that hadn't sold a certain number, half the edition is the formula. You have to sell half the edition to recover your costs. After that is profit. If you sell, let's say you publish, you print 1,000 copies, you have to sell, roughly, rule of thumb, you have to sell 500 in order to recover your investment. After that you make a profit. Now, if within 6 months you haven't sold at least 500 with orders for more, you remain in the book. You no longer want to spend on warehousing. Where do these books go? To the pavement. Pavement sales are remainder books. I used to work in AA, I mentioned it to you. We used to have in-house, AA was one of the largest trade publishers in New York and remained the only independent publisher, the last independent publisher to sell to Bertelsmann about 5 or 6 years ago. It's also where Jackie Kennedy worked. Doubleday used to have in-house sales where all hardbacks for 25 cents, all paperbacks for 10 cents. I built my library on those remainder books. Imagine, the author gets no royalty because it's less than cost. And in your contract it says very clearly, everything sold at less than cost, you don't get anything. 10 cents for paperbacks and 25 cents for hardbacks. You can imagine what that did. Now, when you look at the printed price of a book, let's say the cover price is, I take 500 rupees. 500 rupees? Oh no, let me just take the remainder example. If you're remaindering a book within 6 months, you have to recover something of your investment. How do you do it? You have paid your percentage to the distributor, it's a discounted price already. You have production costs, you have royalty, you have publicity and promotion. Okay? In addition to the material cost of the book and the discount, the distributor's discount, whatever it is. In the US it used to be 33 1/3, it's now much more. But let's say it's less than 50. Even so, you have overheads. That means you have all that is in, and you build into the price of the book the cost of remaindering. The loss of half the edition is built into the price of the book. That is how you get the formula of cost into 5. Cost of the book is 100 rupees, you price it at 500. That's the formula. Because you are building in all this. Now, as I said, this is very much a US phenomenon. We never used to remainder books here. Now you do. You're supposed to pulp them. They are never going to the market for resale. But in India, because of the American convention or the American, you know, occurrence of remaindering, we had in India what are called merchant importers. Merchant importers are people who went every year to Frankfurt. They still do. Every year to Frankfurt, found all the publishers who were remaindering books, brought over a shipment which they bought at the price I mentioned, 10 cents for paperbacks, 25 cents for, or even less because they're buying in bulk. owner passed away is Ramadwani's bookshop in Lucknow. And I cannot tell you what a support he has been to all of us. All of us. He never ordered more than two or three copies. Steadily ordered, paid on dot, made sure he was promoting you. It's wonderful to have a bookseller like that, but now he's gone. The bookshop is closed. Many like this. There's a lovely chap called Salim Sabuwala, who had a mobile bookshop in Maharashtra. He worked only in Maharashtra. He took his van with books only of small publishers, because he said all the big publishers get their books into bookshops, but the smaller publishers don't. For 20 years, he was our best seller of books in Maharashtra. Took his bus to all the small little towns where people would come buy from the bus at the NBT mobile bookshop, and ordered diligently, intelligently, and paid. As soon as he settled our account, he sold your stock, he paid. Made a fresh order, sold, paid. Ordered, sold, paid. It was magic. He stopped now, less than a year ago, because he said nobody's willing to do it. He doesn't have anybody to take it over. So I'm saying you can do that, but these are hit or miss. Hit or miss. You have to rely on the trade. So now, what do you do when there is so much competition and so little space and it's such a tight market? Then, obviously, all your means of promotion and publicity and selling become much, much more aggressive. Much more aggressive. And that's what we are seeing now, actually. So what is the first such tool that a publisher has? One guess. What's your first promotional tool as a publisher? Online? Okay. Sorry?
Reviews.
That's not in your hands. Reviews is not something you can control. I'm talking about what can the publisher do from their end. We can send out review copies, but whether the book ever gets reviewed or not is not in our hands. Although I'm told now, I must tell you the story, but afterwards. So what's the first thing we have that we can do as promotion? Okay, launch.
With a public figure.
Public figure, like Abdul Kalam or someone. Okay, then?
Social media,
okay. Sorry?
Create controversy.
I couldn't hear you.
Create controversy.
Okay. The very first thing that a publisher has as a promotional tool is their catalog. You have a catalog of your books, because you can do a launch for one book, not for 50 books. You can promote a book at a time on social media, you cannot promote your own list. So the first thing that you produce is your catalog. You can have an online catalog. It can be an online distribution of your catalog, but you have to have a catalog. If you don't have a catalog, your list, what you produce, does not go to the trade. By trade, I mean the retail trade and the distribution. They, and believe me, to this day, there are large distributors who say, please don't send us a soft catalog. We want a hard copy. To this day, I was speaking to IBH, just 2 weeks back, and they have a very, very tech-savvy CEO now, whose main work for the next 10 years is going to be digital. That's his project. The CEO, I said, I'm sending you my soft, he said, please, hard copy. Catalog. Why? Because the hard copy goes with the salespeople. Why do you have a hard copy? Every salesman is not sitting like this and going there and saying, acha, inki ye, unki wo, this is that. No, they're not doing that. They are not sitting in front of their laptop and looking at every publisher's list. They are out send out the information and they send us the orders.